Now, ladies and gentlemen, let's give a warm welcome to the next president of the United States, Governor Ronald Reagan. Governor Reagan, it's a distinct pleasure to have you in Chattanooga, and it's a special honor to have you on the campus of Tennessee Temple College. We give you a warm welcome, and at this time we want our people to show you how much we appreciate you coming to Chattanooga and to the campus of Tennessee Temple College. Governor Reagan.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Please, thank you. Well, Mr. Smith, I thank you very much. Dr. Robertson, Dr. Faulkner, Mr. Mayor, members of the state legislature, the other distinguished guests here on the platform, and the students, the faculty, administrators, and the friends of Temple College, I thank you for a most heartwarming welcome. I'm also grateful that you left a... Is this thing still on? I'm also grateful that you left a few minutes before I had to talk after standing backstage and hearing that choir sing so beautifully, that hymn. If you had brought me on a few seconds sooner, I would have been unable to talk. And a welcome like this, you know, I feel a little bit like the old farmer on his porch one night with his wife at the sunset. It was a beautiful sunset, a moving moment, the scent of honeysuckle blowing across the porch. And suddenly he turned to his wife and said, "Martha, sometimes I love you so much I can hardly keep from telling you." Hey, I realize that I'm here in a hat that could be uncomfortable at this particular moment and in these particular surroundings. I've been out as a candidate in the campaign trail. A number of things have been happening out there. They tell me that Jimmy Carter the other day stopped his motorcade on an impulse and went over into a field and told a farmer he'd like to help him. Took the milking stool and the bucket and sat down to milk the cow. Looked up at him and while he was milking, and he said, "I'll bet you Hubert Humphrey wouldn't do this to get your vote." And the farmer says, "You can ask him. He's on the other side of the cow milk." But you know, when I read in the schedule that I was to be here and that this is commencement week and I was to be a part of this, I certainly didn't believe that I could come here as a candidate and making a campaign speech. And yet I was assured that I could. And you know, there was a fellow in the business that I used to be in who saved his money because he aspired to an operatic career. And finally had enough money that he went to Milan, Italy and studied voice. And after about 3 years, he was invited to sing at La Scala, the very spiritual fountainhead of opera. They were doing Pagliacci. And he did the beautiful aria, Vesti la Giubba, and when he had finished singing, the applause from the orchestra seats and the balconies and the galleries was so thunderous and so sustained that they couldn't go on with the opera until he repeated Vesti la Giubba, and he sang it again. And again the same sustained thunderous applause, and again he sang Vesti la Giubba. And this went on, till finally he motioned for quiet, and he tried to tell them how much this meant to him in this, his first appearance in opera. But he said, "I have sung Vesti la Giubba now 9 times. My voice is gone. I cannot do it again." And a voice from the balcony says, "You'll do it till you get it right." And I have been assured that my fears are, I am to calm them and that I am to proceed with a campaign speech. And so I shall do that. I've been speaking on the issues and hopefully drawing the differences that exist between the candidates, which I think is the function of a primary campaign. So I'm going to do as I've been told. You know, over the last 7 years, the federal government in Washington has spent $500,000 on a study that learned that people get angry and tend to clench their jaws and even scream and kick when they feel cheated. And for a great many years, I haven't known anything that has made people clench their jaws, want to kick and scream more than the government in Washington, D.C. I will admit also that along the campaign trail, sometimes when you read some of the things that are being said about you, you have a feeling that you have to go home and explain to your children that you won't eat your young. But Abraham Lincoln, the first Republican president, said that it was possible for a man to be loyal to his government and still disagree with the policies of those in power. And a few weeks ago on television, I listed some of the disagreements that I have with the policies of those in power. Among them is a belief I hold that we cannot be on the road to a solid economic recovery, as we're being told from Washington, as long as that so-called recovery is based on increasing the national debt at a faster rate than we have ever done in our history. We aren't eliminating the economic problems by going deeper into debt at a rate of almost $2 billion a week, almost half of which is interest on the national debt. We are today $95 billion deeper in debt than we were just 12 months ago. I believe what we're doing, instead of curing our economic problems, is trying to treat a fever by breaking the thermometer. Now, in addition to this, governments, federal, state, and local, are taking almost half of every dollar earned in the United States in taxes. No society in history has ever been able to survive such a tax burden over a long period of time. 44 cents is the average. This means that government is the most costly item in the family budget, that it comes to more than food, shelter, and clothing for the family all put together. The Lord tells us that his share is a tenth. When we start computing Caesar's share, it comes out a little different. Now, it's been said in this campaign earlier on that there were no differences, no real issues between the two candidates. As a matter of fact, a senator has recently said that if the two Republican candidates were put in a dark room together, philosophically you couldn't tell them apart. Well, that's because the room is dark. If you turn on the lights, a few differences, I think, might be revealed. I have insisted that one of the differences has to do with our respective experience in government. Mr. Ford has been a member of the Washington establishment for almost his entire adult life, a congressman for more than 25 years, then appointed vice president, and now for 21 months in the White House. I spent most of my adult life out in the private sector, and then spent 8 years as governor of California. If California were a nation, it would be the seventh-ranking economic power in the world today. But when I became governor, California was in about the same condition as New York City, bankrupt. As a matter of fact, the only difference between New York City and Washington is that Washington has a printing press. But being totally inexperienced in government, never having held public office, indeed never having thought I would, or would ever seek such a thing, I knew only one answer to the problems confronting us. Here was California. I had become governor of a state that was spending $1.5 million a day more than it was taking in. Its teachers' retirement fund was an unfunded $4 billion liability hanging over the property owners of our state. Medicaid, my predecessor had spent the entire year's budget in the first 6 months of the fiscal year. There were other ills. I didn't know for a while whether I'd been elected governor or appointed receiver. But I turned to the people of California, the only faith I had. Well, I can't say that. I have a faith. The faith politically that I had was in the people and the people's right to run government. I turned to the people for those who would serve in public office. And I got those that did not want a career in government. I deliberately sought out those who had to be persuaded to make a sacrifice in giving up what they were doing to come in at least for a time And I told them they wouldn't have to stay the full stretch if they couldn't. They could go back to their regular lives, but at least come in for a while. And we put together this kind of administration. For 8 years, we had a kind of watchword among us. We would say to each other, in discussing policy, when we begin to talk about government as we instead of they, we've been here too long. And I would heartily recommend such an attitude in Washington, D.C. Now, we went farther. We went back to the people of California after we'd put our administration together. We gathered in one room what had to be the leadership in our state in the matter of expertise and skill and knowledge, managerial ability. The top people, the busiest people, the most successful. And we told them we wanted them. We wanted them to volunteer, to serve at no expense to the taxpayer, to come in and go into every agency and department of state government and come back and tell us how modern business practices could be put to work to make government more efficient and more responsive. I'm sure that many who volunteered at first thought they would take a few days off and do this or serve on some committees. They ended up giving an average of 117 days apiece, full-time, away from their own occupations. They brought back to us a report with 1,800 specific recommendations. We implemented 1,600 of those. The result was that at the end of 8 years, we turned over to a new administration, no longer a bankrupt state, a state that was not only solvent, a balanced budget, the teacher's retirement fund on a sound actuarial basis, no longer a liability, but we handed them a $500 million surplus, and in the 8 years, we had returned to the people of California in tax rebates and tax cuts $5,761,000,000. And I have to tell you how that happened. A finance director, when we got out of the hole the first time, we had a surplus. And a finance director came to me and he said, we've got a surplus and I know the legislature's going to be thinking of ways to spend it. He said, how would you like to spend it? And I said, let's give it back. And he said, well, it's never been done. And I said, well, I never had an actor up here before either. So I just happen to believe that government has no right to a surplus. Government has a right to take only that money that is needed to run the affairs of government, and if there's any left over at the end of the year, give it back. Now, I realize that's not going to be a problem at the federal level for quite some time. But once having set the pattern, we continue to do it. I found out that if you told the people in advance you wanted to give it back, the legislature was kind of bound to follow suit, even if they objected. And they objected. I had a legislature that was about the same complexion as the Congress in Washington, D.C. today, meaning irresponsible. Well, The third surplus we gave back was $850 million. Now, when you tell a very liberal Democratic legislature that you want to give back $850 million, this is a little like getting between the hog and the bucket. You get jostled about a bit. But we gave it back. One senator indignantly told me that he considered giving that money back an unnecessary expenditure of public funds. Well, I happen to believe that what worked in California can work at the national level if the government in Washington will let the people try. If government will just turn and believe once again in the people. Washington, when it tries to do things that the people should be doing for themselves, Washington is a colossal failure. But it never eliminates a failure. It keeps the present failure and then passes another one on top of it, and the cost goes up and the size of government goes up. A government program once adopted becomes the nearest thing to eternal life that we'll ever see on this earth. You know, Social Security. There's a man in New Jersey who's on disability payments. And the other day he received a letter that told him that they were discontinuing his payments because he's dead. Well, he read the letter, he didn't believe it. So he went to see them. And they couldn't argue with him, there he was, alive. And they couldn't argue with the computer either that said that he was dead. so they didn't know how to reinstate his payments. Well, he was pretty desperate. He was dependent on those for his total livelihood. They tided him over for a while. They gave him $700 to pay for his funeral. The federal government has been trying to build low-cost housing for the poor for more than 20 years. Now, this is a worthy object in itself, except that, number one, it costs the federal government about 20% more than it does the private sector to build a house. But number two, their score to date is they've destroyed 3.5 houses for every one they've built. In North Carolina, Gaston County, while we were campaigning there, we found out that last winter, the federal government gave Gaston County $21,000 to buy heating oil for homes where the people were too poor to keep their houses warm. Now, they've discovered that $20,500 of that went for administrators' salaries and overhead. This was to supervise the buying of $500 worth of oil, 268 gallons. They're also trying to find out what happened to 128 of those gallons that disappeared and no one knows where they went or who got them. Then, of course, there's the woman on welfare in Chicago. She's on welfare under 80 names, 30 addresses, and 15 telephone numbers. When they caught up with her, she had bought her fourth Lincoln Continental, and it is estimated her take is $150,000 a year, tax-free. 3 years ago, we lined up at the gas stations. The Arab oil embargo was on. 500,000 workers in this country lost their jobs, were laid off because there was no fuel to fuel the industries. Project Independence was launched with great fanfare in Washington. Congress said we were going to make this country so independent of outside sources of oil and natural gas that never again could we be blackmailed as we were then. And so they set out to talk about a plan for Project Independence. And they talked. And they talked. And they kept on talking, and if we could have harnessed that hot air, we wouldn't have had to turn the thermostats down. But finally they came up with a plan, and last December the president signed it into law, the Energy Bill. And almost instantly, all over this country, drilling rigs started closing down. Because under this legislation, there is no longer any profit in going out and exploring for oil and gas. No one can afford to do it. And so today we find ourselves, after 3 years of supposed study of the problem, more dependent on outside oil than we ever were. We're importing now more than half of what we consume. We're producing actually less than we were producing 3 years ago. If there is an embargo today, we won't line up at the gas stations because there won't be any gas. And the wheels of industry will grind to a halt and millions of people will be laid off. It is hard for government to realize that sometimes it serves us best when it does nothing. And government should have done nothing about this situation. I believe the energy legislation should be repealed and the industry should be turned loose on the marketplace to find the energy sources we need. I found one the other day. Maybe we'll be in disagreement on this one, where Mr. Ford and I disagree. He has a bill before the Congress, an administration bill as it's called, that is being pressed by the Attorney General that has to do with crime fighting, and in this instance, it is a gun control bill. It is a bill that would make it difficult, if not impossible, for the law-abiding to get a gun, but it wouldn't do anything to keep the criminal from getting one. And this is true of most of the gun control legislation. Now, it is the criminal with a gun that is a problem, not the sportsman or the gun collector or the citizen who maybe wants protection for his own home. I believe in California we found a better approach. The problem is the criminal with a gun. We passed a law that said if someone is convicted of a crime and had a gun in his possession when he committed that crime, add 5 to 15 years to the prison sentence. That has been followed by a second law, and the second law says no judge can find a gun-carrying criminal guilty and turn him back out on the street on probation. He has to serve a mandatory prison sentence. Now, probably some of you have heard here and there a rumor that I have been talking about the Panama Canal. And I have been. the Panama Canal, for 2 years now, we have had a team quietly negotiating what is really a turnover of our sovereignty in the canal zone and the canal itself over a period of time to the government of Panama. The government of Panama happens to be a dictator who seized power militarily 8 years ago, throwing out the duly elected government. There has never been an election since. There are no civil liberties. There is censorship of the press. Evidently, these negotiations were started because he has threatened bloodshed and violence if we don't turn this over to him. But what amazed me when I discovered this was how little the people who really own the canal, the American people, knew about what was going on. That this has been going on. Indeed, there were denials from Washington when I first spoke of this, that it was going on, that we had no intention of doing such a thing. And then congressional testimony was revealed that indicated, yes, we have been and are negotiating it away. Now I've been charged with irresponsibility that the country would go to war or something of the kind if we did not persist with the negotiations. Well, we have negotiated with the Panamanian government twice, 1936 and 1955. In each instance, we arranged things that eliminated points of friction that made us a better neighbor to them. We got along better in both those revisions, but neither treaty, 36 or 55, did we ever permit the negotiating of what the original treaty says are our sovereign rights in the canal zone. Our own Supreme Court has upheld this and has drawn a comparison that the canal zone's purchase and the purchase of Alaska are similar, sovereign United States territory. In the world today, with the Soviet Union boasting the greatest naval force and an offensive naval force designed to cut the sea lanes and interrupt world traffic, I believe it is the height of folly for the United States to consider, particularly under a threat of turning this over. And therefore, I believe that we should continue negotiations if they deal with peripheral issues and things that we can do to help the Panamanians. But we must refuse to negotiate based on giving up our sovereignty and giving up the operation of the canal. But while we're talking things of a foreign nature, earlier this year, Dr. Kissinger said there was no alternative to detente. And Mr. Ford said that no one who advocated abandoning detente could be elected. And I kind of hope he's right, because now he said he's not going to use the word any longer. But he's going to continue the policy. Well, it wasn't the word that bothered us. It was the policy. We're not negotiating in detente anymore from a position of strength. We're negotiating from a position of weakness. Because under our policy in recent years, our military posture has deteriorated to the point that the Secretary of Defense refuses to say that we're still number one. Now, I didn't get my facts out of a crystal ball. I have studied with and consulted with and read the writings of some of the very people that are available to the administration in Washington, indeed some of their own appointees, including the commander of the NATO forces in Europe, the chief of engineering and research in the Pentagon, the top defense expert of the Library of Congress. The secretary of the army has stated that if this country had to go to war tomorrow, it could only equip half its divisions. I believe that Dr. Schlesinger, as secretary of defense, was trying to tell the American people of our deteriorating position in this field, and that's why he is no longer a member of the administration. Now, I feel it does no good for the people of this country to be told repeatedly that, oh, we're the strongest nation on earth, and we go our way. And I understand very well that Mr. Ford has asked the Congress for more money than they've been willing to give him for defense. But I believe the question any longer is no longer one of just weaponry or an imbalance in weaponry. It is one of leadership. We know that the Congress has displayed its irresponsibility and its lack of statesmanship. Every bit of evidence we have, both in the strategic nuclear field and in conventional weapons, reveals that we are second in a world where it is dangerous, if not fatal, to be second best. There is a threat by a godless tyranny abroad in the world today, and we stand between the world and that threat. No one else can pick up and hoist the flag but us. I do not agree with Dr. Kissinger, who says that the reason we're negotiating in the way we are is because you and I, the people of America, lack the will and the stamina to do what is necessary to remain number one. That like old civilizations of the past, we've grown tired, and we're ready for the dustbin of history, perhaps. I don't believe that. I don't believe that you and I lack the will. I believe we lack the truth, the information that our government owes us as to what the situation really is. Mr. Ford has claimed that these are his colleagues and his longtime friends in Congress, and therefore he continues to deal with them. I believe it is time for a president of the United States to take his case to the people of this country over the heads of the Congress. I told you that I was faced with that kind of a legislature, and that's where I learned this. I learned that when they tried to obstruct all the things we wanted to do, that if we told the people the truth and told the people what it was we were trying to accomplish, the people had a way, as I put it, not of making the legislature see the light. They made them feel the heat. Now, there is a kind of a closed shop in Washington, D.C. There is a Washington establishment, and it believes that it does have the answers to all of our problems. And I don't happen to share that faith. I don't believe Washington is the answer. I think Washington is the problem. We can no longer afford politics as usual, nor can we afford an ever-growing leviathan in Washington, a bureaucracy, a buddy system believing in its own omnipotence. Big governments make people small. What we need today are big people making government small. And maybe we need to be reminded just of how big we are. Oh, sure, we all know about our ancestors. We know about what they accomplished in this land. But let's take the living Americans today. We have paid a higher price, fought harder and more often for freedom. Just today's living Americans done more to advance the dignity of man than any people who ever lived on this earth. And frankly, I'm resentful when an elite on the banks of the Potomac seems to think that you and I are incapable, number one, of hearing unpleasant truths, that we mustn't be given the truth unless it's pleasant. I'm increasingly impatient with a government that doesn't believe the housewife can go to the market and buy breakfast cereal without being cheated unless there is a government agency to help her. I don't like it that independent businessmen and women in this country, farmers in this country today, are required to send 10 billion pieces of paper to Washington every year reporting on virtually every facet of everything they do. One congressman has concluded that if the paper just that came into Washington in 1 year from the business community was piled up, it would be a stack 4,500 feet long, 100 feet wide, and 100 feet high. And I think it would make a beautiful bicentennial bonfire. You know, 25 years ago, the Hoover Commission found out that the federal government files a million reports a year just reporting there's nothing to report. No Republican is going to win in November without the help of millions of Democrats and independents. The problems cross party lines, and I believe the people are ready to ignore party lines. I think there is a new majority abroad in this land. In 72, there was a hint of it when millions of Democrats came over and voted Republican. Not because they believed in Republicanism or even understood what it meant, but for the first time at the McGovern Convention, they had seen where their party was taking them, and they voted against. Well, I think that new majority is still there, but this time, let's give them something to vote for instead of just against. What it requires is a statement of principles by us, the things we believe in, and an end to this blurring and fuzzing the lines between the two parties in the hope that someone will get confused and think the two parties are so much alike that it won't make any difference. I was a Democrat most of my life. I became a Republican not because the parties were the same, but because there was a difference. Now, what we have to do, I believe, is pledge, first of all, that we're going to reduce the size and power of the federal government by returning to the states and local communities a number of major programs that never should have been attempted by the federal government in the first place. They belong back here with the people. And one of the first of those is welfare. Here again, we differ. Mr. Ford has announced that he believes we must federalize welfare. He too says it's a failure, but he wants to turn it over to Washington. He wants to go back to the family assistance plan that was defeated about 3 years ago in the United States Senate, but which he voted for as a congressman. It is a guaranteed annual income, pay but no work, and it means that 12 million people would be added to the welfare rolls with the stroke of a pen, and the cost would go to $16 billion more than it presently is. Well, we had a welfare problem in California. We were increasing the caseload 40,000 people a month. We turned to the people again, and a citizens' task force finally, after months of study, brought us a comprehensive plan for welfare reform. We instituted that plan. The result was that in less than 3 years, we reduced the welfare rolls by more than 300,000 people. We saved the taxpayers $2 billion, but we were able to increase the grants to those who truly needed and deserved our help by an average of 43%. We learned something else. Welfare is destroying human beings, not saving them. There is a spiritual side to man that is being neglected in just thinking by meeting their material needs. We believe that in welfare, any reform of welfare that takes place, the answer to saving human beings is to see that able-bodied welfare recipients work at useful community projects in return for their welfare grants. There is another program that I believe belongs back at the local level. We built the greatest public school system the world has ever seen, and we built it at the local level. Now there's a thing called federal aid to education, and federal aid to education has become federal interference with education at every level. When I suggest turning these programs back, I mean also that Washington should turn back the sources of revenue to pay for them, not grants by which they keep strings attached and tell us how we can spend the money. Take the tax source itself and turn it over to the state and the local community for the funding of these programs. And with regard to education, who knows? If we could get Washington out of the classroom, maybe we could get God back in. You confirm something that I have felt all across this land in this campaigning. There is a hunger in this country among our people for a spiritual revival. It is time, I believe, that this nation under God returns to the moral values upon which it was founded, and that we want to believe in ourselves and in our government once again. Now, I'm going to speak again about something I mentioned earlier, our foreign policy. I think this country, we must also tell the people that we will accept our destiny to be a leader in the free world. If we abdicate that responsibility, we abdicate our ability to keep the peace. And I think that means that we ask our people to do whatever is necessary to see that this country remains so strong that no other nation on earth would ever dare test our strength and thus violate the peace. I know there are some that would say that remarks of this kind, these are warlike and hostile, and this is trigger-happy and warmongering. It is not. Not for my generation. We've known four wars in our lifetime. And I don't think there's anyone in this land that doesn't hope and pray that never again will a generation of young men ever have to bleed their finest into battlefields wherever they may be in the world. We want peace, but we've also learned in our lifetime that you can't guarantee that you will always have peace, but we also have learned that you don't have peace through weakness, you have peace only through strength. I think for the past decade or so, this country committed what was one of the great immoralities in our national history. And let our standards also declare to the people of this country, we will never repeat that immorality. We asked young men to fight and die, but we asked them to fight and die not for a cause that we believed was so essential to our national welfare that we had no other choice but to make that request. Never again must young men of this country be asked to fight and die unless it is for a cause so important to this nation that we intend to win it as quickly as possible. There are other things we can say in our standards. Fiscal sanity, balance the budget, end the inflation which is bringing on the economic problems that face us today. All of these things should be done. I would like to go to Washington. I come here seeking your support and help. I'd like to go there not because I believe I can do great things, but because I believe you can, that the people of this country can do great things, can control their destiny, and can ensure that this nation keeps its faith with the God that placed this land here for people to discover it, and that we will indeed be the last best hope of man on earth. Thank you very much.
Now, if you'll take your seat for just a moment, we're happy to have our mayor, the mayor of our city here today, Mayor Charles A. Pat Rose, and Governor Reagan, if you'll come back to the microphone just a moment, we have some presentations to make to you at this time. Governor, Mayor?
It is my pleasure to represent you at this time to tell Governor Reagan that we very much and most sincerely appreciate his concern and his interest in the people of Chattanooga, Tennessee, and the fact that he would take time from a nationwide campaign to come to our city and to share with us the viewpoints that he has to express that would represent his interests and his priorities from the standpoint of the chief executive of our United States. Therefore, I would like to present to Governor Reagan an Ambassador of Goodwill certificate. And by the way, I can't think of anybody that might be more interested in generating goodwill than a presidential candidate. But an Ambassador of Goodwill certificate on behalf of each of you, and Governor, on behalf of many thousands that would be here today, except for the limits of the confines of this building. And we appreciate your coming by our city and sharing with us your comments. It's very obvious to me that you're in the room of a lot of people who I think are typical of the people of our area. These people love the Lord. And they I would simply submit and suggest to you, sir, that I know of no firmer foundation for anyone who aspires to any public service than to have God as his foundation. So may I present to you this Ambassador of Goodwill certificate, a set of cufflinks which have the seal of the City of Chattanooga embossed on them, and I hope that you will remember your visit to us with fond memories and pleasant memories. Thank you, sir.
Governor Reagan, you have a lot of time on your hands, I'm sure, where you can travel from one place to another. You can read some books. I have for you today, we're going to, on behalf of Tennessee Temple College, the 1976 yearbook of Tennessee Temple, a copy of the report of J.B. Collins, the urban affairs editor of the Chattanooga News Free Press, regarding the Highland Park Baptist Church, one of the largest churches in the world, and a catalog about Tennessee Temple schools, and and finally, best of all, let me say that I read in the May 1968 issue of the Christian Life report about your faith in God and your knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. And your Tennessee Temple schools, we believe the Word of God and we teach it. And it's our pleasure to present to you today an autographed copy of the New Testament of the Psalms. And we trust that you'll find comfort and peace as you read this Word of God and put yourself in his will, as you've already stated previously, that you have done. It's a distinct pleasure to have you and an honor to have you on this platform. These are yours too. We want to give the time at this moment to our beloved Chancellor and founder of Tennessee Temple College, Dr. Lee Robertson, a moment to make a comment.
Thank you. I know that you've been inspired by the moments we've had together, and I, too, were impressed by one article given me by a friend that said three things about Governor Reagan. First, his faith in God, in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Secondly, his faith in prayer. And thirdly, his loyalty to his local church. And here with us, that speaks loudly. That's how we believe. We thank God for this hour and for these moments we've had together. God bless you.
Before we leave, let me tell you how pleased we are that you came to this occasion. The Secret Service men have requested that you leave only by the front door, not by the side doors. And as Governor Reagan and those on the platform leave to go out, let's give him one more big round of applause to show him our appreciation for his coming.